calls my youth. My youth is yours, run away now and forever. My youth is yours, the truth so loud you can't ignore my youth. My youth, my youth, my youth is yours.
Well, good morning, how are you? The ladies are at the retreat. I've been hearing some great reports, and God's doing some amazing things there. And so we are here to continue our series. We are in a series where we're looking at subjects that can be a little steamy at times. We've looked at the last few weeks. Today, actually, we're kind of continuing in that same motif where we're talking about God, love, sex. Three valuable words. Three powerful words. There was a seven-year-old girl that is in our church, and she was talking. She saw that on the little flyer, and she told her mom, "God loves sex," and she goes, "No, God loves sex." Three separate things. Reminds me of this guy who, you know, sometimes this whole idea of sex and marriage can be some of the greatest joys in marriage. Sex can also be some of the greatest frustration. And so it reminds me of this guy who. He wasn't feeling well, so he went to the doctor, and he goes, "Doc, I'm not feeling good." He does some tests on him, and he says, "You know what? You only have 18 hours to live." He goes home. He's distraught. He tells his wife. They hug. They cry. They pray. And he goes, "You know, I only have 18 hours to live. I think we should make love. What do you think? Is that okay?" And she goes, "Oh, sure. No problem." So they connect in that way, and there's some love making. And then some time goes by, and then he goes, "You know, I only have 8 hours left." He goes, can we have sex again? Can we make love again?" She goes, "Oh, sure, of course." And so they're close again. They have physical intimacy. And then it's nighttime, and, you know, she says good night. She goes to bed, and he can't sleep. He's tossing and turning, and he's looking at his watch and his clock, and he thinks to himself, "Hey, I only have 3 hours left." And, you know, it pops into his mind. So he wakes up his wife. He goes, "Hey, honey, I only have 3 hours left to live." She goes, "Hey, listen, we've already been close two times now. It's not happening a third time. Besides, I have to get up in the morning and you don't." So this area of sex and marriage can sometimes be divisive, sometimes bring closeness to people. We're going to talk about it again. We're going to talk about how to have great sex. I mean, I can't think of a better topic in church than to talk about how to have great sex, right? And we're going to look at that. The Bible does talk about it. But before that, it's important to lay kind of a groundwork, because the Bible has a foundation on, hey, if you want to have great anything, and in this case, great sex, there's a foundation to build that on. And so that's really important. And we're going to look at the book, Song of Songs. So if you have your Bibles, you open that up, you go to like Psalms, and then just turn a little to the right in the Old Testament, you'll see that there. Of course, you can look it up electronically as well. As you're doing that, I want to just talk real briefly to a few of my single friends that are in here. Sometimes when you're single and you're thinking, hey, I want to meet a special person, and there's different ways that you can do that. One of the ways is, of course, online, Craigslist, the newspaper, you know, ads, all kinds of ways. And some of them, sometimes you have to kind of look for between the lines. What are they really saying? Let me give you a couple examples. One is if a woman says she's 40-ish, what that means is she's 48, okay? 48 or 40. Now, if a guy says he's 40-ish, what it means is he's 52. But he's looking for somebody who's like 25, right? So, but you can do better than that, ladies, okay? So that's, you got to kind of look, you know, what are they really saying? If a guy says that, if he says, "I'm emotionally stable," that should be a red flag right off the bat. Why does he even have to say that? It probably just means that he hasn't had a restraining order in the last 90 days. So he's in a good place right now. If a woman says, she claims, "I love good conversations." Really what that means, guys, is she just talks and talks and talks, blah, 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 just goes on and on and on. And some of you ladies, if you're upset at me, it's because, you're the person, you know. So, If a guy says, I'm huggable, what that means is he needs to lose 40 pounds and he has more hair on his back than a grizzly. And if a girl, if she says, I love being romantic, what that means is she really looks better in candlelight. So, anyways, so you got to read between the lines on that stuff. But as we're, for some of you, you're thinking about marriage. Maybe someday God will bring you somebody, somebody special. Or you're in marriage. These are things that what we talk about today are things you want to be looking for. You want to be looking for. And, of course, if you're married, you want these in place in your marriage. I love this verse. I asked Sharon to memorize it in 5 different translations. She didn't, but here's what it says. In chapter 1, Song of Songs, chapter 1, verse 2, it says, let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for your love is more delightful than wine. Ooh la la. So the Song of Songs, right out of the gate, says, this is kind of the temple. This is what's going on. And it's describing this couple that starts out dating and then courting and then into marriage. And it represents the way it should be. And so that's why it's in there for us to learn and to grow from. So we're going to look at 3 ways to have God in your relationship and then build on that on great ways, just ways that God wants us to have great sex. Number 1 is recognize godly character in each other. This is the first thing that drew them together. This is the thing that attracted them. Not, oh, she's a hottie with a great body. No, it's the noticing this person has character. There's something different in their character. Verse 3, pleasing is the fragrance of your perfumes. And then what's this next phrase? Your name. Say that out loud with me. Your name is like perfume poured out. Other translations says, your name is like purified oil. No wonder the maidens love you. No wonder they want you. Now, what is the idea behind this is back in those days, in these days and times, they didn't have baths. They didn't have plumbing and running water. It's very difficult to take a bath. And Roman baths came in later on, but people just didn't take a lot of baths. So obviously there was a problem with BO, so they would use perfume. They would use these oils, and there's a purification process, very labor intensive, very difficult. And so it became of great value. And she says, your name is like that. Your reputation is comparable to these expensive perfumes and these wonderful oils. Now, one of the sad things is that sometimes ladies, some of the nicest girls, kind of end up with the worst guys. I don't know how it happens. The kindest girls, the ones that are just, they've got everything going for them, they settle for a slug. And it doesn't matter if that guy's abusing her, and she'll say, well, yeah, I see the potential in him. Everybody else sees him as psycho guy, but the girl doesn't see it. And so, how do you make sure that you don't end up in that situation where you have somebody of good character? Well, one of the time-tested ways is look at their friends. Look at their friends before you even start dating them. Now, he might claim he's Mr. Spiritual Man, but if he's hanging around with people that are getting drunk all the time, getting lit, sleeping around, something's not adding up. And so, birds of a feather, they tend to flock together. So you want to look at their friends. Look at the kind of person that they're hanging out with. That will help you because, you see, if you get connected in with somebody who has bad character, it's a high likelihood you're going to end up with heartbreak at some point. And God doesn't want that for you. You certainly, I wouldn't think you would want that for yourself. So you have to think through, how do I make sure and not end up in that situation? So the very first point of attraction for this couple is godly character. Proverbs 12:4 says, a wife of noble what? Character. A wife of noble character is her husband's crown. But a disgraceful wife is like decay to her bones. And so you notice this progression where they have this point of attraction through godly character. And then slowly she's going to start to disclose more of herself. She doesn't just vomit all over him her whole life story on their first date. No, it's something that grows, okay? Number 2 is build godly trust in each other. Build godly trust. And verses 5 and 6, she starts to talk about one of her insecurities. She says, dark am I, yet lovely, O daughters of Jerusalem, dark like the tents of Kedar, like the tent curtains of Solomon. Now, the tents that they're talking about here were dark tents. They would, because they were in kind of a desert climate, so they would absorb the heat. And then through when it, sometimes you'd have a 30, 40 degree change in temperature. And so at night when it got cold, the heat that was that it absorbed in the tents would keep them warm. It'd radiate throughout the tent. And she's comparing herself to that. She says, "Do not stare at me because I am dark, because I am darkened by the sun." She says, "My mother's sons," or she's talking about her brothers, "were angry with me, and they made me take care of the vineyard." She had to work outside all day long. "My own vineyard I have neglected." Now, you'll see all throughout this book, whenever she's talking about her own vineyard, she's talking about her own body. Now, not, obviously, she's not talking about her natural pigmentation, her own natural color. I mean, being dark, having dark skin is beautiful. She's talking about being out in the sun and cooking her skin. See, today, they were smarter than we are today. Today, we actually pay money to go and go to these sunbathing places so that our skin, we can get cancer early. See, that we're, and then our skin can look like a briefcase or an old piece of leather. And for us, we go, "Wow, isn't that awesome?" Well, see, back then, they didn't see that as a value. And so she's kind of saying, "You know, I had to work in the sun, and my skin is representative of that," and she's kind of insecure about that. And she's sharing that with him. This is an opportunity to build trust. Of course, it's the opportunity to tear down trust as well. But when we start opening up insecurities, and the truth is we all have insecurities. Women often. See, guys, if you're found a beautiful woman, maybe you're dating her, you're engaged to her, and you're thinking, "Oh, she is so gorgeous." You might not realize this, but she has insecurities about her body. Most women do. I mean, in our day and age where you have women that are puffed up and shrunken and airbrushed and glossed over and these things that aren't even real people, they're all over and these images everywhere. And so women often have these insecurities, and we have a chance, guys, to speak into that and say and encourage them and build them up. Behind every great marriage is lots and lots of encouragement. Behind every troubling marriage is I guarantee is a lot more discouraging words than encouraging words. And so there's an opportunity to build trust in that. And trust is so important, so vital. And then number three is built to practice godly standards. Now, most marriages today are less than God's best. There's lots of room to grow. There's many of them are broken and are dysfunctional. And if you want something different than what you see around you, you got to do something different. You can't just do what they do and expect different results. And so the way the Bible says is try God's way. Put God's standards into your relationship. It's verse 7, it says, "Tell me, you whom I love, where you graze your flock and where you rest your sheep at midday." She says, "Why would I be like a veiled woman beside the flocks of your friends?" She goes, why am I going to be like everybody else, all these other women, these veiled women that follow you around? Now, this may shock you, but the veiled women she's talking about are women that would actually follow around these guys, and they would offer themselves up for something in exchange. They were basically hookers or prostitutes. And she's going, "I'm not going to be like that. I'm not going to just be a woman that chases you around and offers herself to you. If that's what it's going to take for me to be in a relationship with you, no thank you." And so she sets a standard. And that's what you need to do in a relationship is you set standards. You say, "These are the standards that it's going to take. And if you can't live by this, then you're not the person for me." Now, I want to just give you three standards, but this could just start your list. You should have some standards. And right at the gate, if you don't have a special person in your life yet, you need to be thinking, "Okay, when that person comes into my life, early on, I'm going to have this conversation." Or maybe you're dating or you're engaged. You need to be having this conversation. Here's three. Number one, I will not sacrifice my relationship with God. You see, people draw us closer to God or they draw us away. And you have to say up front, this is a standard. This is non-negotiable. I'm not going to let you, I care about you. I love you, but I love God more. And God is number one, and I'm not going to let you draw me away from God. Number two, second thing is, I will not compromise God's standard. Now, everybody around you might be having sex before they get married, but you just say, I'm not going to do that. And that is kind of the standard in the American culture, right? Everybody tries. Everybody's having sex. Well, you see also a lot of marriage problems. As I said, if you want something different, you need to say, you know what? We're going to establish God and God's standard as number one in our marriage, in our relationship. And so that begins before you're married. You say, this is non-negotiable. If this is what it takes for me to keep you, you're not the person for me. And then number three is, I will not play house. I won't play house. People are sleeping together. People are sharing beds. They're staying over. They're trying all kinds of things. But you just say, no, I want to see a ring. And you walk me down the aisle. Your daddy gives me away. And we make a vow, a covenant before God. And then we play house. But we don't play house some other way. So this progression, godly character, that's what attracts them to each other, build godly trust, and then practice godly standards. Now, as a result, that sets the stage for great sex. Now, when we're going to switch over to Song of Songs chapter 4, so if you have your Bibles, flip over a few chapters. Some of the commentaries that I was looking at, one of them was by F.F. Bruce, the International Bible Commentary. He says about Song of Songs, he says, we shouldn't be studying that today because it's too saucy. Here's what he says. He says, these passages are not suitable for readings in church, and Scripture Union wisely omits them from the family readings. So he says, you're not ready for this stuff. Okay, but I think it makes for a great Bible study. So let's dive right in. Number one, great sex starts before the bedroom. Great sex starts before the bedroom. It lays the groundwork. And so the man understands this in this passage we're looking at, where he courts her. He praises her. He encourages her before he even touches her at all. He doesn't even lift a finger. Verse 11, here's what he says. He says, how beautiful you are, my darling. Oh, how beautiful. Your eyes behind your veil are doves. He says, your hair, a flock of goats descending from Mount Gilead. That's quite a compliment. He says, your hair is like goat hair. Try that. See how that works. What he was saying was, they knew in their day that they had these beautiful goats with long hair on their bodies, and It was like adored. It was like, wow, this. And they would, of course, use this hair to make clothing, and it was some of the finest clothing. And so it's this, in his day, not in our day, in his day, that was a compliment, you know, to say that and shower her with that compliment. He's going, your hair is amazing. It'd be kind of like just saying, you know, some of these conditioner commercials like L'Oreal or Vidal Sassoon, it'd be saying, you have hair just like that, beautiful hair that just, you know, is conditioned with that conditioner. That'd be similar to that. And then, I love this. This might even be his greatest compliment of all. He says, your teeth are like a flock of sheep just shorn, coming up from the washing. And he's going for the big one now. Each of it has its twin. Not one of them is alone. He's looking at her. He's going, you've got all your teeth. Now, listen, if you're desperate for some guys, you know, they're kind of disabled in this area. And so, you know, that you can try that one. Just say, you know, if you're trying to compliment, you've got them all. I mean, I just see every tooth. Actually, you know, they didn't have dentists in these days. That was probably a big accomplishment to make sure and have all your teeth. And he goes, not one of them's alone. I love that. You know, somehow that all worked out for you. Right? Complimenting her. He's really romancing her. He's building her up so that it's setting the stage. This is before the bedroom, guys, before the bedroom, where we need to learn that. And Sharon has helped me learn that sometimes just the little things, it's not always the big things, sets the stage where it's a natural flow as opposed to a duty. physical intimacy. It's just a natural overflow of just all the kind little things that you do throughout the day. And they add up. And you, so you're looking, you know, maybe a phone call, and you just call up and just say, I just want you to know I care about you, I love you, and I was thinking about you. What do you want? I don't want anything, you know. I just wanted to let you know, I was just thinking about you. Or you bring something home, you know, just pick up something at the store that's needed at home. You can, here's one of the things, a trick for you guys, is you can get a rose. You don't have to get a dozen. Most guys think that a dozen means more than a single rose. Actually, for most women, it doesn't. It just means that you're thinking of them. And it's way cheaper, one rose. So it's a little easier to kind of, hey, I'm only going to get one. You know, so just one rose can make a huge difference. Emptying the dishwasher, helping with the kids, changing the diapers or cleaning up, all those kinds of chores that go into it. All those things are important. Here's another thing that I've learned is that there's something that you can do where it's non-sexual touching. Some of the guys are going, what? It is a real thing. I'm telling you, I kid you not, it is a real thing. It's just touching, just because, you know, just as a, you know, affection. There's no honka-honka stuff going on, you know. Just no, there's no strings attached. And that communicates a lot. That's before the bedroom. Not let's get into the bedroom, that's before the bedroom. That's I care about you. Non-sexual touching. All those things really build up a lot. Verse 3, your lips are like a scarlet ribbon. Your mouth is lovely. Your temples behind your veil are like the halves of a pomegranate. Now, he's obviously using his own colloquial situation, but he's saying, and this is before the days of Botox. He's going, hey, man, I like what I see there. And he's even commenting even on her face. He's saying, your face is flush. Obviously, there's excitement. There's passion building. There's something going on there because he's building her up. Number 2, great sex is tender. Verse 5. Now listen to the tenderness of this verse. Your two breasts are like two fawns. Like two fawns of a gazelle that browse among the lilies. Isn't that awesome? It says, your two breasts, they're like fawns that browse among the lilies. Now listen, guys, I know we have a number of hunters in here because you've told me, we've had talks sometimes, and you tell me, now if you're a hunter and you're out on the hunt and you come across two fawns, right, and you're approaching them, how do you approach those fawns? Do you come in right, gentle, right, quiet, stealth, real tender. If you run up and go, hey, you two fawns, they're going to run away, right? And that's not the goal. The goal is to capture those fawns, right? And so you're tender. And guys, we need to recapture that skillful hunter that's in us. You know, they're fawns. You know, we got to be gentle and tender, and we approach it differently. It affects the way we, and so being tender is very important. Kind of on that subject, sometimes a question that will come up will be, what if my spouse wants me to do something sexually that I don't feel comfortable with? How does that work itself out? You know, maybe your mate has a broader parameters of what is acceptable in the marriage bed. Well, here's my response to that. Love making should be tender. You care about the other person. If the other person, if something you like makes the other person feel cheap or used or it's inappropriate in some way, then don't do it. It's that simple. It's not, you're not trying to push the boundaries on what your mate can endure. You're tender about the whole thing. You care about the other person. You don't make them uncomfortable. Number 3, great sex is passionate. It's passionate. Verse 6 says, until the day breaks and the shadows flee. What's he talking about there? All night long, baby. All night long. Praise God. All night long I will go to the mountain of myrrh and to the hill of incense. I'm not going to explain what that means. You have to kind of, you know, project yourself in there a little bit and you can figure it out. You know, it's interesting though, if you look at historical writings on sex, across the board, historical writings on sex connects it to procreation, to having children. You know, you have sex and for children. But here you don't see that. In the Bible, it doesn't make that connection. It just says you have sex because of passion, of just raw, holy passion. And sometimes that gets lost, and it's a shame. How does that get lost? Well, sometimes life just happens, right? I mean, just you get married and you have kids and you're got house payments and you're got chores and shuttling the kids around and the job, and next thing you know, that's just the passion's not there. Maybe there's sex, maybe there isn't, but the passion's not there. And so here we see in the Song of Songs this encouragement: don't let that happen to you. And if it has, you re-engage in the passion. You get passionate again, and you do things. And so, guys, you initiate. You start putting things back on the table again. You say, you know what? We're going to do something about this. Let's start having a regular date night. Let's go out to dinner. I'm going to start complimenting you, and I'm going to get some candles, or you do whatever you need to do. And when you do have kids, it is hard. When you have little kids, it's hard. I remember when our kids, we had three little kids. And so sometimes the only time we could get some time is just put Blue's Clues in. And then we'd go in, we only have 30 minutes, let's go quick, you know. And we did that so much that sometimes Blue's Clues would come on its own and we'd just start wanting to make out, you know. One time we were at Best Buy and we were in the electronics section, Blue's Clues came on and I started panting like Pavlov's dog, you know. You do what you need to do, right? Number four, great sex is built on absolute trust. Absolute trust. Now, I can't think of anything that puts you in this intimate and vulnerable and exciting scenario more than sex in marriage. He says, all beautiful you are, my darling. I love that. All beautiful you are, there is no flaw in you. What's he doing? He's reassuring you. Remember earlier she had said, hey, I have some insecurities about how I look, my skin, because of me, you know, I've been in the sun so much. And what does he do? He looks at her and he reassures her and says, I love that about you. I love that. There's no flaw in you in my eyes. And we can do so much to build up our mate. Sharon has had three children, and three times, she had those kids, and we had complications, and so she ended up having three cesarean sections. And so when I see, I'll tell Sharon, I'll say, you know that stretch mark, I love that about you. Because that shows your self-sacrificing love for me to give me the kids that I have and who I love. Thank you. A lot of women wouldn't do that. They wouldn't go through that kind of self-sacrificing love. She did that. I tell her, I reassure, I love that about you. And in any areas where women, they come with insecurities, you have a role, gentlemen, to play in addressing that and building trust. It's vice versa as well. For you ladies, no matter how secure your guy acts, I can tell you that every guy has insecurities, particularly in the bedroom. They have them. They pretend they don't, but they do. And so you can have a big impact on them as well, where you reassure them. They want to please you. They want to know they're performing well, and there's other insecurities that I don't need to address in this room. But you can address that and just say, I love you just the way you are, and you reassure them. Has a powerful effect on the marriage. Has a powerful effect on having great sex. Now, I just want to say one thing about this area of building trust before we move on to the last point. And I know that sometimes when I talk about this, there's a temptation for the women just to shut down. And they think, well, you're a guy, you don't really know what you're talking about. And that's your choice. But I would ask that you don't, that you just hear me out, that guys are obviously built different than women, right? And would you agree that there's, for most men, they desire sex more frequently, right? There's a greater desire for frequency than women. And that's just the way God made them. They're kind of biologically made like that. And so you probably already know that, right? That's probably not like, oh my goodness, I never knew that. The guys wanted sex more. No, well, you knew that. But here's what you might not know, is that men are very emotionally tied to sex. And so when a woman receives him, he interprets that as, I'm deeply loved, I'm appreciated, I'm valued. It's an emotional thing. A lot of times guys aren't even that aware of it, but it's happening. Very, very emotional. And so every time you reject them physically, it's not just a physical rejection, it's an emotional rejection. And when that happens over and over again, what ends up happening is it starts to devalue their manhood. They start to feel bad about themselves. They start to, the insecurities creep in, all these things that happen. Because it's an emotional thing. So now here's how it relates to trust. When you got married, your guy said, I am going to eliminate all other options to meet that physical and emotional need. You are the one I trust to meet that need. You and you alone. Any other way a guy tries to meet that need that doesn't involve you is wrong and sinful, according to Scripture. It's wrong, and it's sinful. You're the only, he trusts you. He says, for the entire time we're married, I'm going to trust you to meet that need for me. And so that's building trust. That's a part of the guy you marry. He's not sick. He's got problems. No, God made him differently. And that's part of the way that you build trust in that area. Okay? And then number five, the last point, is great sex is sensuous. It's sensuous. It's voluptuous. There's something sensual about the whole thing. Verses 9, 10, 11 at first says, you've stolen my heart, my sister, my bride. You've stolen my heart with one glance of your eyes. In other words, at the first hello, you got me. With one jewel of your necklace. How delightful is your love, my sister, my bride. How much more pleasing is your love than wine and the fragrance of your perfume than any spice. And then verse 11, your lips drop sweetness as the honeycomb, my bride. Milk and honey are under your tongue. Wow, that's pretty sexy to me. Woo! But here's, and even now things really ramp up, okay? Verses 15 and 16. Now remember, he's using a garden as a metaphor. You are a garden fountain. A well of flowing water streaming down from Lebanon. Verse 16, awake north wind and come south wind. Blow on my garden that its fragrance may spread abroad. Let my lover come into his garden and taste its choice fruits. Maybe F.F. Bruce was right. Yeah, this is a little steamy, right? Now listen, guys, you might be thinking, hey, well, I'm not really a Romeo. Well, you married a Juliet. She wants to be romanced. That's an important part of having great sex. It's an important part of a marriage that is growing and is thriving. And you don't just do the same thing over and over and over for 14 years straight, 20 years straight or whatever. And so one of the things Sharon and I do is to help keep the romance going in our marriage. Among other things, is we make sure, and at least once, twice, three times a year, we'll get away for a day or two at a. Sometimes it's just a bed and breakfast. Sharon loves those kinds of things. It's just lace pillows and lace this and lace. She loves lace, little truffles and chocolates, and she just goes wild on that stuff. And I'm cool with it. It's cool, you know. And that just keeps things going. And you've got to initiate and say, I'm not going to just let this thing drift. You've got to put the gas on the pedal. Here's a list of things that you can do that will help your wife, guys, get ready for passionate lovemaking. Ready? Here's some things. You can caress, praise, pamper, relish, savor, massage, make plans, fix, empathize, serenade, compliment, support, tantalize, humor, purr, hug, cuddle, excite, pacify, stroke, protect, phone, text, correspond, anticipate, nuzzle, smooch, jiffy lube, minister to, forgive, sacrifice for, entertain, charm, show, equality for, spackle, trust, brag about, sanctify, help, acknowledge, polish, embrace, upgrade, accept, butter up, hear, understand, jitterbug, beg, bleed, borrow, steal, clean, swim, nourish, resuscitate, respect, entertain, kill for, die for, dream of, promise, deliver, tease, flirt, commit, snuggle, snooze, snurfle, elevate, enervate, serve, love, ribs, salivate, bite, taste, nibble, gratify, take her to places, diddle, doodle, hokey pokey, hanky panky, flip, flop, fly, don't care if I die, swing, slip, slide, slather, squeeze, moisturize, humidify, lather, tingle, slam dunk, keep on rocking until the free world, slick gelatize, brush, tingle, dribble, dry, niff, fluff, fold, integrate, indulge, wow, dazzle, amaze, flabbergast, exchange, idolize, and worship, and then go back, Jack, and do it again, okay? Those are some things you can do. And now, ladies, you can do something to help get things going, to initiate. Have you ever seen Gomer Pyle? Anybody remember Gomer Pyle? He had some crazy phrases, right? Well, what you do, this is for you ladies, okay? You show up in a robe, nothing else on, and right when he comes up, you open up the robe and go, surprise, surprise, surprise. You do things to say, I want to make this better than it is. If you're in a rut, if you're in a tough spot, you go, it doesn't have to be like this. We can change it, and it can start with me. If you're single and you're not there and you're thinking, you know, that's something I want in the future, you start saying, well, I'm going to set some ground rules. These are going to be some standards I'm going to set that are non-negotiable. Okay, let's pray now. Well, Heavenly Father, I speak life and health over every soul here. No matter what station they are, whether they're married or divorced or single or single again or whatever. Father, I just pray for your refreshing, that we all commit to your standards, to have godly character. We can expect that from others when we're looking at who we're going to date, who we're going to marry. But we can't control others. We can certainly expect that. But we can control ourselves. And would you just say, God, today, I want that. I want godly character. I want to build my life where it's trustworthy. You know, I was praying for you this morning and I felt like the Lord said that there's mercy for confessions. I thought, well, that's kind of an odd phrase. And what I felt like God was saying was, sure, it might include confessions of stuff we've done wrong, but confessions, there's something, you know, when we pray out loud, that becomes a confession. There's confessional churches where they what that means is they have certain creeds, and when they proclaim them, they're saying, this is what we believe is to be true. I believe God's offering that. He's saying there's a place for that right now. Maybe your confessions over your situation in life. Maybe you've gravitated toward the negativity. And so you say, God, today I'm going to start making positive confessions about my life. Positive confessions about who I am in you. And your care for me. And then you just do that. And I would encourage you to do that maybe under your breath a little bit. You know, not just to think a prayer, but to actually say it. Just whisper to God. Say, God, I want to be a godly person. I want to uphold your standards. Maybe there is a place for you, because as you think about it, the Holy Spirit spotlight is on you, and you're realizing, you know what, I'm kind of living like the world. If somebody looked at my relationship, other than prayer and maybe reading the Bible from here or there, I'm not a whole lot different. Except for it's less frequent and I have more guilt. Well, that's certainly not what God wants for you. Why don't I just say, God, today, I'm going to take him up on his offer. There's mercy for confessions for you. Say, today it's going to be different. With your help, with your strength. And then if you're married, you just confess, say, God, I want to make new confessions about my spouse. Speak, and when they share their insecurities, I want to be healing to them with my words. I want to build absolute trust. If you've never put your faith in Christ, why not do that right now? Just say, Jesus Christ, come into my life. Give me the power to live a life of heaven on earth, not just a life for heaven someday, where I can experience the power of God. We sang that song earlier, that Christ lives in me. So just invite him into your life. Say, God, I want you to live in me, live in my heart, live in my soul, in my mind. Direct me. And let your standards impress upon me and be my standards. In Jesus' name, amen.